So when I think of Frank Sinatra, I don't think about Frank Sinatra singing songs about Chicago. Do you?
Oh, me?
Yeah.
I mean, I guess I do because I've seen this
New
movie.
New York, New York. You know what I mean? Like, it was weird to see Frank Sinatra being like, Chicago's my kind of town. Like,
I love that number.
I like it. It was just, when I think of Frank Sinatra, I'm not that I'm saying I don't like Frank Sinatra. I'm not the most educated Frank Sinatra fan.
I see your point. He is more associated with New York.
He's from Patterson, right? I mean, or he's from Hoboken.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's from that area of the world. I mean, I know Hoboken's New Jersey, so roast me, New Jersey people, but
he sings New York, New York.
Yeah,
so
yeah, that's what but I will tell you, My Kind of Town is a song that I sent to one of my very close friends who is a Chicagoland native, longtime Chicagoland native, and I sent it to him. And I was like, you know, this song's pretty good. This is a good Chicago song. I'd never heard it before.
What did your friend say?
He was like, you know, that's Frank Sinatra. And I was like, yeah, it is. It's like, great. No. That was about the extent of it. But man, you know what's exciting, though? I was not expecting the film that we're talking about on this episode of the Culture Cast, Robin and the Seven Hoods.
Want to hear a wild idea? Robin Hood. Yeah. Robin Hood in Chicago. No, no, no. No bows and arrows. None of that.
Easy. Let's take it easy.
You think that's wild? Well, they went and did it. Called it, now get this, Robin and the Seven Hoods. Frank Sinatra is Robin.
It's like when they started the United States, you know, they put all the states together and they made one union. And I'm like the vice president.
Give my regards to Martha.
Dean Martin is Little John. Sammy Davis Jr. is Will Scarlet. Alan Adeo, you know who they got? Bing Crosby, for heaven's sakes.
You're a very popular man, Mr. Robbo. An honest-to-goodness Robin Hood.
Who's Maid Marian, you ask? Barbara Rush.
How do I get the feeling I'm being had?
Now take it easy, fellas. This is just a trailer. Let the management hasten to assure you that this Robin maintains the same high ideals as his literary progenitors. Take, for example, the emphasis on civic spirit.
My kind of town.
Chicago!
My kind of town.
Chicago!
And for a great big hunk of old-fashioned, red-blooded sentiment, you'll have to go a long way to match this one.
But I say a man who loves his mother is man enough for me.
What's your racket?
I'm a brain surgeon.
What boy wouldn't thrill at this stirring call to the manly art of self-defense?
Cause no one I know gets so such a glow out of bang, bang like me.
Could anyone doubt a production that includes an ethical exhortation of this caliber?
Take it from me, don't be a do-batterer. Do better, you put your foot on that ladder to lead you to that place.
Tireless in their search for uplifting themes, our stars even find time for the sartorial virtues.
God, or you haven't got style.
And to polish it all off, a screen full of pretty faces.
Though she came from Charleston, Charleston, Charlotte couldn't Charleston, couldn't Charleston to save her soul.
Okay. continuing our little comedy mafia movie month over here. I did not expect this movie, because again, I didn't look it up before I watched it. I like going into movies completely blind and then doing the research after. I was not expecting it to be a musical. I guess I should have figured, but when Peter Falk started singing, and here's the funny thing, Colin Gallagher of Pulp Serenade is actually the creator of the theme song for The Shabby Detective, a podcast about Peter Falk's most famous character he played, Columbo. And that's who's joining me on this episode. And Colin, correct me if I'm wrong, did you help me pick this one?
Yes, I'm okay. The one who put this in your suggestion list.
Great. So on this episode, we're talking about Robin and the Seven Hoods, if you can't tell. It is a mobster retelling of the classic Robin Hood story transplanted to 1920s Chicago gangster setting. And it's a musical film. So that's what we're going to be talking about on this episode. So it's directed by Gordon Douglas, screenplay by David R. Schwartz. It stars, obviously, Frank Sinatra. Who else? Cullen Dean Martin. Who else? Peter Lawford. Oh, no. Bing Crosby. I mean, sorry.
And Energy Robinson in a great little cameo at the beginning.
Right. Sammy Davis Jr. How do you uncredit Edward G. Robinson? Like, it's not like anyone's not going to know who he is.
So what I wonder about that is if it's like, because Edward G. Robinson is, you know, famous as Little Caesar. I wonder if like that's supposed to be like a surprise, because it's not like social media is going to be like everyone on their phone. Oh, Edward G. Robinson is in this movie before they get there. Like, I wonder if that's like a little treat for people that would have been seeing this. Or maybe there's something like contractual where, like, you know, he did it as a favor. And
that's kind of my assumption, is like, you know, hey, Edward G. Robinson, you want to be in this like Frank Sinatra movie? Sure. Why not? Like, do I have to do anything? No, just like stand here, do the gangster thing, and then just get shot. So the film is, like I mentioned, it's about it's a Robin Hood retelling with Frank Sinatra playing the hilariously named character of Robbo. I mean, can we both agree that Robbo is like a really, it's a dorky name? Why not just have him be called Robin or Rob or anything else?
I didn't mind it. It's awkward.
It's just kind of awkward, right? The first scene has them going, "Where's Robbo?" And I was like, "Who the fuck is Robbo?" I'll wait for Robbo to get here to make my assumption as to who he is.
I will say this. I've never heard anyone called Robbo before.
Or since. Or no. Ever.
I'm okay with that.
Sure. No, I mean, look, yeah.
It's goofy. It's goofy.
Right.
But it's a goofy movie.
So that's the thing. I don't find this movie nearly as funny as I think this movie wants to be. It's like there is some stuff in this movie where characters are getting killed and put into concrete blocks.
Like, it's gruesome. Like, it's
it is pretty goddamn gruesome.
It's a classic, like, hard-boiled gangster story with some numbers thrown in.
Right, with Bing Crosby dancing and singing with a Robin Hood hat on.
And I mean, if we get to it now or later, the most magnificent, among the most magnificent musical numbers I think ever filmed, Sammy Davis Jr. destroying a casino, you know, shooting all the bottles and grabbing a Tommy gun and dancing on top of a bar.
Like, and what's he singing about in that song, Cullen?
He likes the Rudy Toot Toot.
What is the Rudy Toot Toot, Cullen?
The sound of the guns going off.
Yeah, Sammy Davis Jr. sings a song in this film called Bang Bang, which is about shooting people and using guns and the sound that the guns make. It is amazing. 110% makes... There are few and far between things that are like, you need to watch the movie for this. That scene is... It's bizarre to the point of like, I couldn't even believe what I was watching. Like... It's great, but it's very strange.
It's ecstatic, and it's. Yeah. I mean, I wasn't getting like I think that is just one of the best musical numbers of all time, and just his charisma, like the way he moves, you know, his singing, his dancing, his body language. There's just so much artistry and energy. Like, how can you take your eyes off that guy? Like,
right.
He just fucking commands the screen when he's on. And I just love that they give him that number. It's like, he doesn't need anyone else. That is just him. So
he barely does anything else in the movie. I mean, if he's in it for like, it feels like that scene is the scene where they're like, Sammy, do your thing.
Yeah.
And he, I mean, look, it's a Rat Pack movie. So like, you know what you kind of know what you're getting when you get yourself into a Rat Pack movie. I think this, you know, we'll talk about when we talk about kind of the Rat Pack proper, but I'm curious, Cullen, why did you pick this movie?
Because you said gangster comedy, and this is the first thing that, and you also said you had a lot of like newer movies. And so it's just like classic gangster comedy. And I'm like, what's something that I think is really funny that doesn't get talked about a lot? And I was like, Robin and the Seven Hoods.
Yeah, I mean, again, like you mentioned, I mean, the last movie we talked about, Oscar, which is over on Patreon, is from 91. This is from 64. So, yeah, it's
I also thought Richard would have liked it, who's not here with us tonight.
Right. We're thinking about Richard. Our good friend Richard Haddam is currently under the weather, which is unfortunate, because, yeah.
Feel better, Richard.
Feel better, Richard. Yeah, Richard would have loved this movie. This feels like Richard's speed, right? Like, this is in his wheelhouse, 100%.
I was looking forward to hearing your comments as well, but, you know, I was trying to think of something that would have been a fun, you know, conversation for the three of us to have.
Right.
And I feel like there's so many good people in this movie. I mean, I'm a huge Gordon Douglas fan, and we can go through his filmography, you know, at some point, because he's a really underrated director and has an incredibly long career.
Yes.
And then you got people like Alan Jenkins, who's the mobster who's always, his suggestion is always, can someone open the window? And he, like, right. he goes back to like 30s Warner Brothers movies. So to have him in there for me was just like, oh my God, that just made me so happy. And I'm sure everyone on that set is like, that guy is a legend. He is hanging out here. You know, he and Edward G. Robinson had, you know, basically created these archetypes that people are riffing on.
You know who I really, really love? Victor Buono.
Oh my God. He is great in this, I thought.
Yeah. So I've seen a lot of Victor Buono recently. So on Rankin and Bass last year, we talked about The Flight of the Dragons, which he did a voice in. And then also last year, when we did the Patreon month, we talked about Murder Can Hurt You, where he played the like fake Ironsides character. And he's fantastic in that. But in this, I mean, in this, he's great, obviously. But I love just seeing him in things because he just has a great look.
His eyes are unlike anyone else's.
Yeah, he's so good. And his voice, and he has a presence on screen because he's a big guy. I mean, he's a big dude. Like, he's pretty tall. He's a pretty husky guy. And he's given the opportunity to, you know, ham it up as the villain in this movie because he's playing Alvin Potts' sheriff, but he's the sheriff of Nottingham. I mean, you know, you have Frank Sinatra playing Robin Hood. Dean Martin plays Little John. Mm-hmm. Sammy Davis Jr. I don't know.
He plays Will Scarlet.
Right. I'm not super into the Robin Hood mythos, so I just, some of the characters I didn't know, they're one-to-one, so I had to look it up. But everybody that's in the normal Robin Hood story is represented here, at least the main characters, and they do something interesting with the Maid Marian character, even.
Yeah.
Like, genuinely, I would say genuinely shocking decision to take that character in the direction that they took her in.
Yeah, she's a gangster.
Yeah, she's in a way that at the beginning of the film, when Frank Sinatra meets her, he goes, oh, Big Jim in women's clothing. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that, you know, that's the Edward G. Robinson character who dies at the beginning of the movie by getting shot by everybody.
Oh, yeah. I just love it. It's like his birthday party. And then there's just a shot of everyone pointing their gun right at the camera.
Like, stand up and take a bow, and then they just, like, blow him away. And again, we kind of mentioned him a little bit, but man, Peter Falk in this movie.
I love him singing. And one of the things I like about him singing, and I really enjoy musicals, especially from this era, that embrace the fact that the guy singing might not actually be good at singing.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But he does it, and it's not, he does it in such a way that it's like, you know, he's hitting the notes, but it's like, it's not about the singing. It's about the delivery of the lines in a musical way.
Right.
He just has this like rhythmic, it's a strange rhythm too, because Peter Falk, no one talks like him.
No, right, right, but, exactly.
But I just, that's what I like about it. It's not like, okay, it's not like I'm going to be getting a Frank Sinatra, you know, or Dean Martin number out of him. He does something totally different. And it's like the first number. It's like, all right, I didn't expect this song to come up. I didn't expect this type of song.
Well, and the funny thing is, he looks like the least lip syncing of all the people who sing in the movie, and he's not the professionally trained singer. All the other actors are, you know, Sinatra, Dean Martin, Sammy Davis Jr.
He's probably the soberest one on the set.
Well, there is that too. I mean, yeah. To say that the set for this movie was probably insanity is underselling it. Because again, it's a Rat Pack movie. You get all those guys together. What were they known for? You know,
they partied.
Right. Exactly. And this is, you know, this is right in the middle of Kennedy getting assassinated.
Sinatra's son was kidnapped during right? the making of this movie.
Sinatra had a massive fallout with one of his best friends because of this movie. Peter Lawford, who I mentioned at the top jokingly, he's replaced by Bing Crosby, you know, before the movie really even gets going. And it's interesting because, again, talking about actors or singers playing roles in movies, Bing Crosby playing against type big time. Like, and surprisingly good.
Yeah, he's great. I love that number he leads in the Church of Mr. Booze.
Yeah, he's great. It's weird. Like, it's not that I didn't like this movie. I think my issue with this movie is it was a little long for its own good.
Yeah, it's 2 hours over, long. Just over 2 hours. Yeah, it's like 2:05. I think it could have been cut to like 155, 150. Kept it going a little.
Yeah.
But here's something. I was fine. I watched it again today. I'm fine with the length. One of the things I kind of like about it is it's not a movie that like has like a peak and then, you know, a nice slow coda. It just sort of keeps going and going and going. And then, you know, the characters keep getting out of different jams. They keep busting up each other's places. And then it just hits a point where they're just like, all right, all these... we're not fighting this battle. And they like jump out of a window. And then there's like a coda at the end. Like it ends very abruptly. Like it just keeps running and running and running. And it's like, all right, time to call it a day. We have a 2-hour movie.
Honestly, I felt like the ending of the film was the weakest part of the film. And I'm not talking just, about what happens. I'm talking about what you just said. Like I'm speaking to more the fact that it was like, and the movie just ended. Like,
yeah, it just runs out of steam. And then it's just like, cool. Let's just throw on like a little joke at the end, and that's
it. Like, oh, there's Victor Buono. Like, he must be in that stone block. Da 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 da. Think, like, guys, there had to be a better way to do that. Well, there has to be a better way to end your film than just like.
Yeah.
But also, it feels very of the time. Like, I've seen plenty of movies from the 60s that just kind of end. This isn't the only one. Like,
no, it's. You know, what I do find also interesting is this is sort of, you know, basically the end of the golden era of the classic Hollywood musical.
Right.
Because, like, Viva Las Vegas in some ways is sort of seen as, you know, kind of the last great musical in some of that era in some ways. And this is right around the same time. And I think Hollywood was going through a period of, well, what the hell do we do? Do we keep redoing what we did in the past? Well, you know, studios are kind of having trouble, you know, with finances, stars are changing, what the audience wants is changing. And I think this is a good example of like, well, what are we doing? And I find it really interesting for that, for the ways that it embraces the past, bringing someone like Bing Crosby back. But it's also like the twilight of Crosby's career.
Right.
This is one of the last films he does.
Yeah, and it's like I had mentioned, it's an interesting role because it's not the role when someone says Bing Crosby's in this movie, this is not the role you would expect. This isn't another, even the role you would dream up for him, frankly. Like
another role that I do love Bing Crosby in is what he makes next with the same director, Gordon Douglas, the remake of Stagecoach, with Anne Margaret, Alex Cord, RIP, Red Buttons, Van Heflin, Slim Pickens, a lot of great people. But Bing Crosby plays I believe he plays the whiskey drummer.
Interesting.
And it's another sort of like cameo part, like in a bigger ensemble.
Huh. Yeah. Bing Crosby is, I think most of us know Bing Crosby from his Christmas music.
But yeah, I mean, yeah, White Christmas, High Society. I mean, did he win the Oscar for The Country Girl? Nominated? Definitely nominated.
He won for Going My Way.
Yeah. Another. Yeah. TCM staple, you know, the road movies with Bob Hope,
right? And you know, I mean, again, everything else Bing Crosby aside, Bing Crosby recently, yeah, obviously lots of not so nice things come out about the man. Unfortunately, I've tried not to let that color my feelings of him on the film, but sounded like very much a man of the 60s, of that generation, as it were, you know. Cold and not there because he was always busy.
Yeah, that's what I've heard.
Yeah, but it, you know, again, he's very charismatic on screen, playing again an interesting character, playing the Alan Dale character. And I would have liked to have seen Peter Lawford in the role, but I think having Bing Crosby just makes this film it makes it feel a little special.
I like that his character sort of comes halfway through the movie. He's not there from the beginning. Like, it's a nice, like, midpoint surprise.
Right. Yeah, and they have to make it believable that a guy like him, an upstanding guy, would get involved with these, you know, quote, this unsavory element of mobsters. And believable. I found his reasoning and motivation in the film to be believable. That he's, you know, trying to do the right thing by these charities and trying to do the right thing by this orphanage. And, you know, he wants to do the right thing with Robbo's gang as opposed to Rob, you know, because Robbo's gang's obviously, you know, giving to the poor from the rich, Robin Hood, you know. So it's like he's the PR man for Robin Hood. And it's a really interesting twist on that story.
And it's also because it's an accident. Right. Sinatra didn't want to do that. It's, you know, the daughter was paying him for a murder that he didn't do.
Right.
And he's just like, well, get rid of the money. And one of his goons is just like, let's give it to let's give it away to an orphanage.
And, yeah. And the orphanage's director just happens to be Alan Dale, the Bing Crosby character. But it's an interesting twist on the Robin Hood story. Cause yeah, the Robin Hood story is, you know, he robs from the rich to give to the poor. And this, it's, he's not really robbing from the rich. He's just kind of giving away money, you know, because it helps his public, it helps his kind of public appeal.
Someone could do an interesting twist on that today, because like watching it today, I was really like noticing like how much this has to do with like, you know, public relations and, you know, it's all, you know, it's, you wouldn't say social media, but it's like, oh, all the people, you know, have the signs, they like him, they're in support of him. You know, he doesn't want to like, you know, you can't upset the fans. You can't, you know. The fans are. It's like even Peter Falk is like, well, we can't touch him. He's too popular.
Right. It's that perception versus reality thing. Like the reality of it is he is a gangster, but the perception is he's this like ne'er-do-well philanthropist gangster. And it's like, it doesn't work that way. It's not real. But
and how do you get him? You have to poison the image and turn the people against him.
Right. Which again, it's like you said, it's interesting because this movie feels ahead of its time with the way it handles its plot. Like the beats of the Robbo character becoming like the man about town that everybody loves. Like that's pretty smart and pretty forward thinking for 64.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's great. I loved it.
I also like that, you know, like Sinatra's character, he's not, they don't make him cozy.
No.
Like he's not a
nice guy.
No, he's not. He's, you know, he's a cad, you know, he's a gangster and, you know, he's hard boiled, you know, he's charming, but you know, you wouldn't want to cross him. But I like that they didn't sort of make him a teddy bear and give him like a sentimental side.
Yeah, I'm with you. I mean, that's the thing about Robin Hood in a lot of the stories that is missed is there should be an edge because he's still a criminal, even though he's a criminal with good intentions. He still needs to have that seedier, edgier part of his personality. And sometimes they steer way too far into it with something like, the Robin Hood movie that came out recently with Taron Egerton and Jamie Foxx, which was not great. But they steer into the whole, like, he's killing people and he's edgy, but he also gives back to people. And that's like, it seems like a newer interpretation of Robin Hood, as opposed to this film was, I feel like it's ahead of the curve here. Because, like, making Robin Hood less than savory, I think is an interesting way of taking, interesting direction of taking the character.
No, that's true. And I've been reading.
You didn't see it a lot at the time. Like, you didn't see people going, Robin Hood is still kind of a bad guy. Like, he's not a good person.
No. This reminds me, because I've been reading all these W.R. Burnett novels, and he's the one who wrote Little Caesar, which arguably is the start of the modern gangster novel, and then when it's adapted to Hollywood, the modern gangster movie. And so much of the archetypes that he creates in the novel and then that are recreated in the movie still hold true today. But just that constant, you know, that ambition that, you know, the everybody's backstabbing everybody trying to get to the top. And I thought this movie did a good job of, you know, staying true to that. There felt like there were stakes.
Yeah.
Like, you know, and especially I like the twist, to give anything away, sorry if people haven't seen it. After Sinatra wins a trial, where they tried to, you know, frame him for murder, I thought the movie could have realistically had him lose the trial. Like, the stakes felt that real to me. I thought dramatically that was a possibility. And then when he gets out and goes back to his old operation, you know, the daughter has sort of moved in and, you know, taken over and is now doing counterfeiting, you know?
And is it, you know, you know what I thought you were going to say? I thought you were going to say the movie could have logistically ended when he got out of court.
Oh, I mean, it could have.
It felt like a conclusion. Like I think it was probably the way that they shot the scene from like above and you see him like getting into the car. I was like, there's still 20 minutes left in this movie. There's no way it's over, but it feels like he could just, you know, he won the trial and he's going back to his life to be whatever. But no, there's a whole nother, it feels kind of like the coda to the movie almost. Where
it's like a whole nother third.
Yeah, yeah, it is.
But that's, I liked that twist. It's not a common beat. It's not what you would expect.
Right.
So for me, that was something that I'm like, okay, that kept the movie interesting to me.
Yeah. No, it's like, all right, so he wins the murder trial, but then there's still more things going on. I mean, they still have to tie up Peter Falk. They still have to tie up Victor Buono. But just that shot, that scene feels so like a finale of a film. Most movies, it feels like that would be the final shot of him, like, coming out of the courthouse. Everybody's out in the streets cheering for him. There you go. And I like it didn't end that way, but it was just, it was a little strange. I was taken aback, I guess.
And I mean, that also just feels like the end of that movie feels very in key with the sort of archetypes that Burnett creates, where, you know, the story ends when the con is up, when it's just like, cool, everybody's dead in jail or like out on their ass. Right. And that's the way this story, you know, winds up unfolding. It's like those people go as far as they can with their scheme and it just hits a point where it's like, we've lost.
And they are smart enough characters to know when they've lost and when to abandon ship as to not go down with the ship, which is, again, atypical of mafia stories. Like, most of the time, the mafia characters just ride the ship into the ground or ride it into the iceberg or whatever, however you want to put it. Rarely do they jump off the ship before it sinks. They go down with it. And this one, they're dressed up like Santa Claus is at the end of the film, panhandling money, you know. It's a pretty undignified end, but I love it.
I don't think that change is going to any orphans.
No.
I think it's going to pay their bar tab.
And I like that the Bing Crosby character gets one over on them in the end.
Yeah, I didn't see that coming.
Well, I didn't see it coming either, but it really makes me laugh at the, and when I think about the song that they do with Bing Crosby, where it's the Styles song, and if you think about it if you think about the way the film ended, like, he was just waiting for his opportunity to stick it to those two assholes. Like, that's the way I bet he was thinking. Like, I just can't wait. Give me an opportunity to stick it to him, and I will. And he did. I mean, he does in the end. I mean, he's the last man standing.
He is. Oh, he and the daughter.
Right, but I think
she's going to be the last one standing.
Well, yeah. The next scene is he's in another cement block. But yeah. There aren't enough cement blocks in the world to put all these characters in, so she has to stop at some point. There's a lot of, yeah, like we mentioned at the top, this movie is pretty gruesome in a way that movies from then were, where they don't show anything, they just imply it.
I love when all the gangsters are trying to like pitch to Peter Falk how to like kill off Sinatra or the the sheriff before it's Victor Buono. And they're talking about taking him to the steel factory, and Peter Falk's just like, no, that's out of town, that's too far. Just like, yeah, I thought he was just so good. I mean, he's hamming it up 100%.
Oh yeah.
And I love when he's at the in the trial, and he's like, he'll stop what he's doing to explain the gangster slang to the judge. And then he even comments to, about the judge. Yeah, he's a good guy, the judge. He's just such a ham, and he owns himself. It.
Yeah, he almost overshadows everybody else in the movie. He's that good. He is that good in this movie. I mean, he's that good in general, right? I mean, Peter Falk is not known for being a bad actor. Let's just put it that way. Like, he's known for playing a character that is unassuming.
And this is a movie with big personalities. They come out with the biggest personality.
Right.
You got to be pretty large.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. And again, when he started singing, I was just like, I wasn't expecting Peter Falk to start singing, but here we are. And I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it a lot. I think, again, even my issue with the runtime in this movie, I don't know if I would suggest it, but what I would say is it's a good musical.
It's a mess, but I sometimes love messes, and there's a lot of great moments in it.
I feel like if they had gone more into the direction of spoofs, it might have worked a little bit better. Because it almost doesn't feel like a spoof at times. Sometimes it feels like a straight-up gangster movie.
But with songs.
And to me, that inherently can't work. The fact that it does work here is, like you've mentioned, it's kind of like 9 times out of 10, this doesn't work. The one time that it does, it's this movie. And even this movie is still kind of a mess, but it's less of a mess than the other kinds of movies like this one. And I'm okay with that. And it's carried on the backs of the actors and the direction.
I was going to say, yeah, just the amount of money that's poured into this is
right.
A lot. And to be superficial, I could not stop staring at the suits.
Right.
As you mentioned this, you got to have style.
Right.
That song is just so wonderful. And it's great to seeing Bing Crosby keep coming out of the closet in the goofiest suits. But goddamn, just watching everybody wear like the most magnificent suits. They know how to dress, or rather they know someone who knows how to dress them very well.
Right,
but they know how to walk in these clothes. Victor Buono's suit. I'm just looking at that guy and I'm like, you look like $1 million, dude.
Exactly. Oh yeah. No,
it's so much eye candy. It's just like, I don't know. I feel like you don't see this many men dressed this fucking well in a movie these days.
I agree. It was a point of pride, obviously. I mean, that's where, the budget had to go somewhere, and I think they left it all on screen.
Building those sets that they just destroy a couple times.
Right. Oh yeah, that too.
And then they build that set that can flip-flop from like a gambling casino into like a where Bing Crosby, there's a name for it where he's preaching and all the people.
Like the chapel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Chapel, that's what it's called.
Yeah. That scene's fantastic.
The revival meeting.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, that set, they tell an architect, we want a club that can transform, with the flip of a switch from a casino into a chapel. And it exists in this movie. You see it happen.
Right.
That's insane.
I think for me, other than the runtime, my other big kind of issue with the movie is wishing that Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr. had more to do. And I mentioned it when I was talking about Sammy Davis Jr. with Bang Bang, and Dean Martin gets his own solo song. They only each get one solo song, if you're not Frank Sinatra. It's unfortunate, because I know Sinatra's charismatic. They have to tone down his charisma in this movie so that he's a little bit more rapscallion than, you know, old Blue Eyes, but I don't understand underserving two actors who are just as charismatic in Sammy Davis Jr. and Dean Martin.
I think there's just too many people.
I know. I agree. I think that's
too many people, too much plot, a little overambitious.
I think,
I like that. I like that everyone gets their, like, that Dean Martin number where he's like playing pool, talking about, you know, his mother and singing. It's just like, that guy is just so cool.
Yeah.
Like, so smooth. And it's a quiet song. It's not a big bombastic number, which is also a little like unusual.
Right.
Like everybody else, like the Sammy Davis Jr. number, like that brings down the house. The one you talked about, Sinatra out on the steps with all the people and the camera angles. The Dean Martin number is just, they turn the lights down low. He's just moving around the pool table. It's an unusual musical number, especially for someone like him.
Exactly. And that's, and for me, like, again, I know what Sinatra's capable of. I wanted to see Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr. because I'm, you were talking about fucking blind spots recently. The Rat Pack stuff is not something I've seen a whole lot of. So I was hoping that this would be more Rat Pack and less Sinatra with his pals kind of hanging around. Because, I mean, Little John is not a small character in the Robin Hood story. Like, he's Robin Hood's right-hand man.
Yeah.
And he's, I'm not sure if I would go as far as to say he's not given anything to do, but he's not given as much to do as I would expect a character like him would be.
His main role in this movie is to, you know, provide the idea that they should go bust up Peter Falk's casino.
Right.
And then at the end, you know, he's sort of involved with, you know, the daughter getting involved. You know, involved with the counterfeiting.
Right. She tries to kind of, she tries to grease him up so that he will be the next victim to fall prey to being put into a cement block. And he's like, I'm with Robbo. I'm not with you.
Nope.
Yeah.
But that's why he's there.
And Sammy Davis Jr. I feel like is given even less to do. It's unfortunate. Yeah. It's unfortunate, but like that's, of all my issues with this movie, that's my big one, is it is kind of the Frank Sinatra show, not so much the Rat Pack. Maybe this is the way all the Rat Pack movies are. I haven't seen enough of them to have an opinion.
I'd like to see them all again. I felt happy seeing all of everybody on the screen and getting their numbers. So maybe having seen them all, it's a different perspective from you who haven't seen a lot of them yet. For me, this was just pure pleasure, just again seeing, you know, Alan Jenkins getting a little bit of Edward G. Robinson. It's just so many wonderful mugs.
Oh yeah, I mean the looks, the faces on these guys, right? So just, oh my lord, just, I mean, they have that look, right? They look convincing.
Yeah, I mean, just like in Oscar, like, you know, this, we were saying with Oscar, it's like, okay, this, you know, is played straight, and it's just like, well, Robin and the Seven Hoods is played even straighter.
Right. Yeah. I mean, this is, I'm not going to say it's not played for laughs, but I don't think there's not a lot of laughs in this movie.
Well, it's not Screwball.
No, it's not even funny, really.
Oh, I thought all the Peter Falk stuff was like a gas.
Well, the Peter Falk stuff is funny, but I don't think anything else is funny, though, is kind of what I was getting at. Like, there's some comedic stuff, but it's not funny the way Oscar was. And again, it's funny in more like a isn't this absurd kind of way.
I mean, I see your point. I do think it takes like the gang, what would have been the gangster plot, you know, the classic gangster plot, and, you know, hoax it up a little bit. I feel like the Sinatra, you know, Rat Pack stuff, that's more serious than the Peter Falk side of things.
Yeah, I agree.
And I feel like I love like the Mr. Booze number. I mean, to me, that's funny as hell.
Yeah. I can see what you're getting at. Yeah, I would agree. It's just, again, like, it's just, it's tonally a mess, I would say.
How many movies have I really liked on this podcast that are totally a mess? Quite a few.
I don't think the Owl movie was a tonal mess, but you know, I don't think either one of us really liked the Owl movie, so maybe that one.
I felt very uncomfortable with By the Owl movie. I still don't know what to make of it.
I like how of all the things that I have had you watch for this show, the Owl movie was the it's the one, folks.
It's a strange movie because I don't watch those types of movies.
No.
It's just like, I don't know what to think of them. Whereas something like this, maybe it's a little more of a deep cut in terms of, you know, where it is in the canon, but it's a strange movie. And I like a strange movie that even if it doesn't always work, you know, it goes for something. Sometimes it lands a few of them.
Yeah, and you know, like you said, there is part of me that appreciates when a movie does something different. And it's not part of me, it's a huge part of me, because who doesn't love movies that try something different, right?
There's probably somebody, whoever the ideal viewer that's Marvel is, you know, plotting for their next movie.
Oh, taking them to task. All right. I mean, it's fair.
I like some of the Marvels. I like the Marvel stuff that like goes like outside of the box. Like, I love MODOK. I think that is hilarious, that show.
I haven't seen it, but I've heard good things.
I thought WandaVision was terrific.
Do something different for a change, right?
Yeah, I tried watching Hawkeye, and I loved the comics, but that first episode, I was like, this is what you have? Like, you're not leading with, if you're leading with your strongest episode, this isn't much of a hook.
Also, that comic run that they based that series off of is too good to adapt it into a show.
Yeah.
It's too, like, why are you even trying? I'm sorry. I mean, we're completely off topic, but I, like yourself, I watched a couple episodes. I was like, I'm just going to go read the comics. I'm going to go read that run from, like, what? Like mid, like 2015, 2016. I'll go read that. This is what they're ripping off, and it's
pizza
not as good.
Pizza is my business. That's one of the comics that turned me on to comics.
Yeah, I'm curious when we think about Frank Sinatra. What is the Sinatra Rat Pack movie? What is it? What is the Rat Pack movie that people think of?
I think he has actually a pretty extraordinary filmography. He's, when you go through it, like the number of great movies that guy made.
Dirty Dingus McGee.
And I like it.
I just like the name. Who wouldn't like the name? Come on.
So
Dirty
I'm gonna go
Dingus
back.
McGee.
Oh, I forgot. He's in Reveille with Beverly as himself. Okay. So, I mean, you got Anchors Away, On the Town, From Here to Eternity. Suddenly, you know, the movie about the assassination is terrific. You know, Young at Heart, I love Guys and Dolls, Tender Trap, Man with the Golden Arm, High Society, Joker's Wild, Pal Joey, Some Came Running, The Vincent Minnelli is amazing. Never So Few is all right, the John Sturges, got Ocean's 11, Sergeant's 3, another Rat Pack. It's like a Western take on Gunga Din, Manchurian Candidate, 4 for Texas, another Gordon Douglas movie, None But the Brave. You know, we're only up to like 66. This guy's made. I'm leaving out a ton. Like, you still got like Tony Rome, the detective, Lady in Cement. Like, that guy made a hell of a lot of really good movies, and I, you know, a lot of them are serious. Like, they're not all musicals. They're not all comedies. There's a lot of drama. There's some war pictures. Some action. There's some westerns. I think he was actually a pretty versatile actor.
And there's one movie missing from his filmography that I really wish was on his filmography.
What?
Die Hard. You didn't know about? Yeah, he was the actor that they wanted for Die Hard.
Oh, whoa. I did not know that. Uh-huh. Instead of Bruce Willis?
Well, he was like the original. I think he was the one that they approached initially, yeah.
In the 80s?
Yeah, I mean, he was still alive. And that would have been a different movie, but...
Oh, wow.
Well, because isn't it based off of a book?
It's based on a book, yeah.
That the Roderick Thorpe book, right?
I think that's who wrote it.
And that
I've never been able to find a copy.
Roderick Thorpe's book, The Detective, was adapted and had Sinatra in it, so...
Oh, man. Yeah, this is blowing my mind. I would watch that. I mean, when were they... Was this, like, back in the 70s they wanted to do it? 70s, early 80s?
Yeah, I think it was, like, the early 80s. I mean, Sinatra was 70 at the time, and they were contractually obligated, but he only turned it down after they offered it to him. He didn't say, like, I won't do it. And they approached plenty of people, too, who were varying ages as well. So it's not like they were only approaching, you know, older people or younger people. If it had been Frank Sinatra, that would have been an interesting movie. I'm not saying it would have worked, but I don't know.
What Sinatra movies have you seen?
This one.
Oh, this is the only one?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I know him from all of his singing.
Oh, man, if I had known that, I don't know if I would have picked this as the first one to introduce Sinatra to you.
It's good, though. He's charismatic. He's just, he's abrasive.
Yeah.
But, like, that's kind of what I expected in a way. When people talk about Sinatra, I'm just like, there was always this, like, rough around the edges thing with Sinatra. Like, the whole mafia possible association. That's a little rough around the edges, right? Like,
yeah, one thing I do like about Sinatra. So he was close friends with Judy Garland, and when she would need to get away from her abusive husband, she would call him up, and he and his guys would come over and make sure she was okay while she and her family got out. So
see, that's a stand-up guy.
Yeah.
Also a scary guy.
Yeah.
All of him and his pals show up, fucking run. Just run. I mean, run. Like, yeah. Frank Sinatra will beat the shit out of you. I believe that wholeheartedly.
But, you know, it's interesting. I mean, for a first Frank Sinatra film, I think this is almost like par for the course Sinatra. Like, it's not like an amazing performance. It's Sinatra doing just like, yeah, I'm Sinatra.
He's like kind of playing himself.
Yeah.
Which was kind of what we said with the Elvis movies last year. Which is kind of, to be honest with you, that's what I was expecting with this movie.
But that's not Sinatra's typical.
Right.
On screen, he'd normally, like in the Rat Pack movies, he's a little bit more like, I'm Sinatra. But most of the rest of his career, he's doing other stuff.
Right. Yeah, I mean, there were, what, 5 Rat Pack movies? And he did how many other movies? Because we didn't even mention all of them, so...
No, I just literally picked off like the ones that I would consider just like great movies.
Right.
Like worth seeing. And there's others I still haven't seen. There's stuff I also didn't mention that are like decent. They're like, okay, these are fun. If you're a big fan, they're worth seeing.
And hey, as someone who's currently reading The Godfather, just knowing that Johnny Fontaine is the, you know, is essentially Sinatra. I just, every time they say Fontaine, I just imagine they're saying Sinatra instead in the book. And it cracks me up because it's like, now I understand why Frank Sinatra hated Mario Puzo. I get it now, like 100%. Because it's not a very, glowing character study that they have in that book of his character.
No.
No. He's, yeah.
That'd be fun to reread.
It's a, you know, talking about mafia movies this month, I had started talking about these comedy mafia movies. The kind of the germ of this idea started back in September when I started watching The Sopranos, and I fell in love with it immediately. We talked about it last year a couple times, and it has supplanted The X-Files as my favorite TV show.
That's great. That makes me want to rewatch the show because I haven't seen it since... I mean, basically since it aired, like I caught them all, like my mom would tape them and then I would watch them.
Right.
So I would see them like a month later.
But it put me on this path to revisit The Godfather over the Christmas holiday, which I did. I rewatched the first one, the second one, and then the, what's it called? Mario Puzo's The Godfather, : The Death of Michael Corleone, which is...
That's the new version of the third movie.
Yeah, brevity is the soul of wit, as they would say, with the title that fucking long.
So what's the difference between that and the third movie?
It's not trying to be a sequel, but it, like, Coppola's like, this is not the sequel. This is, the entire film is the epilogue to the first two movies. Which, again, I haven't seen the third one's original cut. That's the problem. And I'm not sure if I ever will. Unless I'm on an episode of something where someone's like, you need to watch the two of them. But you know what the big thing is? He doesn't die at the end of the movie. it's like the spiritual death of Michael Corleone, not the physical death. Because that's, I mean, the way I interpret the third movie is it's watching everything that he's built up unravel in front of him. And, you know, what the conclusion of the film is still the same with the Sofia Coppola character. And it's like, that's the spiritual death of Michael Corleone, is this movie watching him die slowly because he makes bad decision after bad decision to go back into the mob. You know, just when I got out, they pulled me back in.
So it's like the same story as the third movie.
Yeah, the story is the same. I think it's just from everything that I've read about how the third movie normally was versus now, the third movie now gets to the story faster. It gets to the onus of the conflict immediately. This film opens with him talking to the guy, the archbishop or whatever in the Vatican immediately. That's the opening scene. And I don't think that's how the film opens originally. I think it's trimmed down a little bit. It's still 3 hours or whatever. I think it's like 2.5 hours. I enjoyed it. I don't understand the hatred. It's one of those movies that's aged, I think. I think it's a movie worth reappraising.
Yeah. I haven't seen the third movie in probably 25 years. So I barely remember it.
So the first Godfather is almost 3 hours. The second Godfather is 3 hours. And the third Godfather is almost 3 hours. So it's like 9 hours worth of movies. By the end of the third movie, I was not disappointed by the conclusion. The conclusion felt like the logical conclusion for this story. And in my opinion, that's a success.
Yeah.
Given how lauded Godfather 1 is and Godfather 2, Godfather 3, I think, deserves to be in that conversation. And if people are ragging on it, it's probably because they haven't seen it in a long time or have never seen it at all. It's one of those movies that gets a bad rap because of how good the other two movies are. Let's not kid ourselves. I mean, that's really what this is all about. Is it's not as good as the first two movies, but no shit, one of those movies is one of or both of are the some of the greatest movies ever made.
It's hard to live up to them.
How the fuck can you hold a candle to that?
Like, I mean, that's why Critters 3 is so remarkable.
Oh my god, the fucking slam dunk from Cullen. That's why Critters. I still haven't seen Critters 3.
I hope I don't overhype it.
I didn't. You know what, Cullen? We're going to have to do a Critters episode at some point because I feel like Critters is what I wanted from Gremlins. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. I'd like to go back and revisit Gremlins. It's been a long time. I remember liking them, but Critters, that franchise, is what I often want from like a horror comedy.
Right. I'm with you. I want the horror to still be there.
Yeah.
And boy, is it. Like, Critters, it's still kind of, I mean, it is a scary movie. Like, it's a horror movie. And the critters are, I mean, there's a critter sitting next to you on your couch right now.
Yeah.
And it's cute, but, like, they will still kill you.
Oh, hell yeah. Those teeth? Those teeth are meant for eat chomping.
And the fact that they're called Krites is just, it really is. Just, like, hang a fucking lantern on it. Scene one, ladies and gentlemen, the Krites. Oh boy. So Cullen, would you suggest Robin and the Seven Hoods?
You know, I would. I would use the word delightful. It's not too goofy. It's, to me, it's funny. I think it's got a lot of great numbers. It's got a lot of very charismatic actors and performers. I think it's an entertaining movie.
Yeah, I would agree. I have my quibbles with it. It has some problems. But I think, you know, you get three of these actors, the Rat Pack actors on screen together. You get Peter Falk. You get the Rat Pack actors, and then you get Bing Crosby, Peter Falk, Barbara Rush, Victor Buono, all the other, you know, random little people that are here. Bernard Fine, Edward G. Robinson, Tony Randall at one point. You get all these people together, and you make something interesting. Is it completely 100% a success? No. But does it have to be? No. It's a lot more successful than I thought a movie like it would be. And that's okay.
Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah. So, on that note, let's take a break, and we'll play a preview for the next film for Comedy Mafia Month.
The story of the Cortino crime family began on the streets of old New York.
Hi, Anthony. How's my favorite florist?
This is for you.
When a simple florist...
You know, your papa never paid me what he owes.
...discovered his destiny.
Hi, florist!
From these humble beginnings, he rose to become the head of a mafia empire.
Anthony, they're criminals.
I'm not my father, Diane, just as you're not your father. We were our fathers. What we did last night would only be legal in Arkansas.
Until one day, his past caught up with him.
Say hello to my little friend.
How bad is it?
You lost a lot of blood, but we found most of it.
Oh.
A while ago, I was shot 47 times. It really got me thinking.
How lucky.
Touchstone Pictures invites you into a dangerous world of ruthless men.
Boogie, boogie, boogie.
The murderers.
Criminals are people too, Diane. If you prick a murderer, does he not leave a blood trail all the way back to his Rockingham estate?
Powerful women.
Hey.
Torrid romance.
You don't own me, Anthony.
That's why we don't have nice things, Pepper.
Get out of my life!
And a crime wave that's taking the nation by storm.
El Nino.
This summer, behold the underbelly of the underworld. Jane Austen's Mafia.
What's your name?
Diane.
Like me.
I named him after his mother.
I'm a mother?
And that's right, on the next episode, we're going to be talking about a movie just titled Mafia. Jane Austen's Mafia, but Jane Austen's Mafia. We're going to be talking about that, and I'm going to be joined by my good friend, Mr. Mike White. Have you ever seen Jane Austen's Mafia, Cullen?
No, but I like the way you say it. It sounds funny.
It's you've seen Airplane, right?
Yeah, I love
you've
it.
You've seen Naked Gun, right?
Love it.
It's Mafia. Mafia is just Naked Gun, but with Mafia movies.
This sounds great.
Goodfellas, Casino, Godfather, they're all parodied. There's parodies of all kinds of stuff. It's a Zucker movie. It's, in my opinion, the last great Zucker movie. So if you've never seen it, definitely check it out. Make sure to show up for the next episode. If you've never seen the movie, you should watch it beforehand. Because it's a comedy. I don't know how we're going to talk about it, because there's a lot of sight gags. It's replete with sight gags. But until then, Cullen, where could people find you if they were looking?
I'm at www.cullengallagher.com. That's got links to my new albums, new pieces when I publish them. And then you can always check out my blog, pulp-serenade.com. There is one new post. I'll have to do one for 2023, but there's one new one for this year.
There you go. I mean, hey, averaging one a year, maybe in a couple of years it'll get up to two. Who knows? As long as it's one.
Yeah. There have been years where I didn't post anything new. So, yeah, keep the bar low.
And as for me, you can find me over at cstachew.com, C-S-T-A-C-H-I-W.com. That's my link tree with all the things that I work on. Scary Stories We Tell, Rankin on Bass, they're all there for your listening pleasure. As for this podcast, culturecast.com, patreon.com/culturecast, those are the places you can go to listen and to kick a couple dollars our way if that's a thing that you're into. If not, hey, I totally get it. Times are hard. Cullen, thank you so much for joining me and for helping program the month. This was a good movie.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.
Cullen streak continues, ladies and gentlemen. We're batting, I think, 10 for 10 or whatever it is. So,
thank you for having me on. It's always a pleasure.
It's my pleasure.